whenever I veer off of my truth, I easily get depressed and discouraged, and I feel like I'm living my life for someone else. And I think that's a really big blessing for me, because I can't veer way too far without checking myself and being like, oh, actually, let's rethink. How do you want to spend your time? How do you want to spend your energy? How do you want to spend like this precious life that you have on the planet? So I think it's really important to think about, well, what is the life that you want to lead? Start taking little steps to make that happen and feel the results yourself.
First generation queer Filipina American, Angelia Angel Trinidad is the CEO and founder of Passion Planner, a paper life coach created from her parents' garage. Since then, Passion Planner has now helped 1.5 million people live in their purpose with less stress and more fun. Now a thriving multi-million dollar company, Passion Planner gives back through a growing Get One, Give One program, donating over 500,000 planners each year to empower schools and nonprofit organizations all around the world. Let's welcome Angelia Angel Trinidad.
Angel, oh Angel, thank you so much for being here. It's a gift and an honor to have you.
Thank you so much for having me.
Of course. So I want the world to know who you are, how you got to where you are, and all that jazz. So let's start from the beginning. Where did you grow up? What was your childhood like?
So my name is Angel Trinidad. I'm the CEO and founder of Passion Planner. I was born and raised in San Diego, California. And then I went out to LA to go to school. And Passion Planner, for anyone that doesn't know, is a paper planner designed to pretty much be a paper life coach for people. And it helps people break down their goal. Well, pretty much map them out first, their long and short-term goals, break them down to steps, and take those steps and put them into their day-to-day life. Because a lot of people don't do that. They go through their life going through the motions and chasing goals that might not be theirs. So using this planner gives you an opportunity to think about, what is it that matters to you, and how can you create a game plan around that, even though maybe someone has never done it. So more background on me. I am a queer first generation Filipina American. I was raised by a Navy father, and my mom is a medical assistant. So, you know, very Filipino American background. And yeah.
Cool. And so you went to UCLA for entrepreneurship?
So I actually went to UCLA. I started as a pre-med major for my first 2 years, and I ended up switching my major to art without telling my parents, and they were very disappointed. But I knew that I was studying way more than I was sleeping, and if I was going to do something with the time that I had on this planet, I wanted to do something that I loved. So without telling them, I applied to the art department, got rejected the first time, took some art classes, luckily got accepted the second time. And even though I didn't really know exactly what I wanted to do with my career, I just knew that I wanted to learn and have a different path. And that was pretty challenging, because my parents and everyone expected me to become a doctor or something in the medical industry. So that was rough, but it felt so difficult to go down a path that didn't feel true to me. And I learned that very, very quickly, that was like pushing me into depression. And I was like, I can't do that. So yeah, I changed my major.
For those that are in the midst of that, of wanting to do this, but their family or parents or whoever wants them to do this, what would you say is a thing or two that they can just step into their truth? Because like you said, you are living your true self, and it's super inspirational.
I think we all know the answer to a lot of very big questions. And I think that for me, I was a lot of people, like from the outside looking in, I would imagine that people would say my life is really ironic. Because I was raised in an extremely religious background, and then I turned out to be queer. I started as, I was an overachieving student that wanted to eventually be an art major. My parents never wanted me to be an entrepreneur, and then I turned out to be an entrepreneur. And it was me taking these small, courageous steps that felt really true to me. And realizing that when I did take those steps, my whole life didn't crumble. It actually got better. And maybe in the beginning it was difficult and resistant, but those things were external, not internal. And the internal thinking and the internal drive was a lot easier to push through all of these hard things. Whenever I veer off of my truth, I easily get depressed and discouraged, and I feel like I'm living my life for someone else. And I think that's a really big blessing for me, because I can't veer way too far without checking myself and being like, oh, actually, let's rethink. How do you want to spend your time? How do you want to spend your energy? How do you want to spend like this precious life that you have on the planet? Because I mean, a lot of things have reminded me of death, and a lot of things have reminded me of this concept of, wow, we're really lucky. We're so lucky. Being Filipino American, I'm like so lucky to have so many choices of how I can shape my career. And, you know, people are going to maybe talk, but that's it. They're just going to talk. And I'm okay with people talking and judging me. And I just know that regardless of if you do what you love or you don't, someone's going to talk shit. It's going to happen, you know? So I think it's really important to think about, well, what is the life that you want to lead? Start taking little steps to make that happen and feel the results yourself. Because I think that's at least how the only way that I can stay motivated and inspired is by leading and charting my own path, even as that evolves and grows and changes. I really think that growth is when you can let like each moment unfold without judgment of what it was supposed to be, but what it is actually. So I don't know. I take this philosophy with everything that I do.
I love it. And I see and I observe and I could feel that just energy that you have of living your truth. One of the acronyms that I share in regards to life, L-I-F-E, is to live in full expression, L-I-F-E. Live in full expression to who you are, to who you truly are, because like you said, life is short, life is gentle, life is, you know, can be short. In which way, why not do all the things right now? So in your journey, actually, let me back up a little bit. Passion planner, how did that idea even come about? Were you already into planners, so forth and so on?
Yeah. I mean, I've always been a huge paper person, like a huge planner geek. And I've used a planner since high school. And after graduating from college, I had slipped into about a depression, because you go from being at UCLA, feeling like you are competing with the best. Life is literally moving so fast, like light speed. And then you go home. Well, I moved home to my parents and, you know, back to that same room, back to that same energy. And my parents really wanted me to find like a normal job, but I didn't want that for myself. I really wanted to do something different because I didn't want to exchange my time for money. Like, I didn't think that that was the most strategic way to go about making money. I knew that I wanted to be an entrepreneur in some way, shape, or form. And I was like, okay, well, I really want to help people. Like, and I thought about what really helped me, and it was a planner. A planner helped me organize my thoughts, like help my ADHD brain focus and make sure I dedicated time to all of the things that I wanted to do. And then I was like, okay, well, I mind mapped all of the things that I wanted in a planner, and then I designed it in Photoshop and Word. And then I found a manufacturer on Alibaba. You just Google it. You just Google everything. And then I launched a Kickstarter I asked one of my friends that did video, hey, can you shoot this Kickstarter video with me? And luckily he helped me, and we shot it in the middle of the night. And I was so nervous to talk in front of a camera. It took 4 hours to record a 3-minute long video. And it got to the point where I was laying down on the piano bench that they had me sit on and just doing voiceover in the fourth hour because I couldn't talk to the camera anymore. So I launched it, and within the first 10 minutes, someone had backed it, and it was someone that I didn't know, which was amazing. And then by the end of that 30 days, I had raised $48,000. with this little planner. And the next year decided to launch another size of it and raise $650,000 in 30 days, which kind of just changed my whole life because that was just on Kickstarter. Off Kickstarter, I think we did like $1.2 million on the website. So effectively did $2 million over the course of 3 months of a planner. And it was me, my two assistants in my parents' garage, just, you know, like weathering the storm.
Wow. And so along this journey of entrepreneurship, what would you say are a couple of myths that you want to debunk based on entrepreneurship that people might see it as?
Yeah, I think entrepreneurship should be very intentional and it should be designed to fit your end goals. A lot of times people think about entrepreneurship and they think about like this hustle and this grind of, you know, I have to work 18-hour days, I need to be the hardest working person on the planet, and I need to strive for perfection. And I personally don't think that that is sustainable. I really think that you should define what you want your business to do for you and base your decisions around that. So, and you should define how much revenue you want to build, because if not, you're constantly chasing after something that is going to continue to grow. Like, I think about money in a sense of how can it serve me and how can it be a tool in my life to make my life simpler and easier and more fun. A lot of people don't think about it that way. They think about how much, what is the biggest dollar amount that I can make? But I'm like, if you can't do anything with that money, then what's the point? So for me, I think entrepreneurship needs to be very intentional with how you build the business so that it serves you, because there's many ways to build a business. For me, like, I really prioritize freedom and I really prioritize like harmony and balance within my employees and within myself. So that's a huge priority to me. And I spend lots of money and time to ensure that that happens for not only me, but for my team. So it's not always a bottom line situation. So that is one of the things that you can build your business the way that you want so that it serves your life, as opposed to you being a servant to your business. So there's that. I think that is one of them. And I think that the overwork toxic hustle culture is completely overrated. I understand that there is a level of hustle and a level of dedication that needs to be done. But I really do believe in working smarter and not harder. My little corgi just came in and said hello. And she's reminding me of that too. She says, yes, smarter, not harder. So yeah, I think that there are so many people that have so many great answers. If you're willing to listen to them, if you're willing to read their books, if you're really willing to pay for their webinars, that there are so many ways to work smarter and not harder and implement that into your entrepreneurial game plan. So you're not just grinding for the sake of hard work.
Right. Yeah. What would you say is or has been one of your proudest moments along the way?
I think it's funny because it ties into what I had just talked about, which is the balance. So for me, one of the biggest things, I guess it's two things, which was when I first rolled out full benefits to my team. We have like a 401k, vision, dental, and vision. Do we have dental? No, we only have vision and health. Maybe we should think about dental. Teeth are important. But when I rolled that out, and I remember my mom, when I was still in the garage, she was like, so when are you going to find a real job with benefits? And at that time, it's funny, I have told this story before, but I had already made $1 million. And she just came at me with all these questions. So when I had told her, like, oh, now I have benefits, and so did my whole team, like, that was just a huge win for me. Because it was just not something that she had conceptualized as possible. So that was really cool. And also just knowing that my team was going to be taken care of, that was huge for me. And they wouldn't have to worry about insurance. I think that's one of the plaguing questions that millennials face. It's like, well, what do we do about healthcare? So that, and then also being able to roll up Passion Weeks, which is a week for, each person on our team to, get up to $3,000 to explore a passion that they have. And they get paid to do it for a week. They can travel, they can not travel, they can explore a hobby, So one of our teammates, she hiked Mount Fuji. Another one raced race cars. Another one decided that he just wanted to take a week-long vacation in Mexico with his PlayStation. Like, that's what he needed to do for him. And, there's just so many stories. And every year, everyone gets a passion week after their first 6 months or a year, something like that, to just explore something about the world that they're interested in.
That's powerful. What do you do to take care of your mind, body, and soul? Because I've seen a lot of your recent posts, and I'm like, that's what I'm talking about. Oh, that, you know what? I needed to hear that today. So it's definitely, you know, super inspiring and fruitful for my mind, body, and spirit. And so you being who you are, I know that it's your inner world that creates your outer world. And so what do you do to take care of you?
I do a lot. I take naps every single day, almost every single day. I'd say like 90% of my days I have a nap, and it's scheduled and it's in there and it's serious. Like I have two mornings because I get to take a nap. Like I have the morning when I wake up really early in the morning, and then I have the morning when I wake up after my nap. And I know that that's when my brain functions the best, and that's when I'm the happiest. So that's definitely one thing. A lot of times people think about like self-care and self-help, and it's like really, really difficult because it's too complicated. For me, I'm like, move your body, try to eat well, and sleep. Like, do those things. Get those things down first. And don't try to overcomplicate it. But I also think when I talk about like feeding your body, like also understanding what kind of energy you're feeding your body. Like, what music are you listening to? What are you listening to in terms of like podcasts? What are you watching? Who are you talking to? Like, that's all really important for your mental health, because I think it's really important who you surround yourself is that energy that you're around really affects your mental state. So that, I read a lot. Like, I'm a voracious reader. I read like 2 to 3 books every week. But I listen to audiobooks, and it's always on topics that interest me. I never read because I feel like I should read. I always read because I want to read. So I think that's a huge thing. And then I also have a lot of support. So I have a great team of assistants. I mean, I have a great team at Passion Planner. I have my executive coach, I have my therapist, I have people that I meet on Instagram, I have my friend group. Like, I have a lot of people that I can rely on and lean on. And I also think like me being there in a community with people that I talk to consistently and I'm there for them is really important because we're social beings, and we need social interaction. We need to feel like we're in a group. And it's pretty hard during COVID, but I think, calling a friend, texting them, checking in on them, just being like, hey, how are you doing? I think is really, really important. I also love gaming, which I think is really funny because a lot of people don't think about gaming as like a mental health tool. But I do, because I think it's a way that I love to play. Playing to me is a huge, huge, huge part of my life. So I love to play. I make as many things in my life as playful as possible. And I play StarCraft, which is a really old game that was like made in the 90s. I don't know, maybe 2000s. And I love this game, and it's strategic enough, and it's not three-dimensional, so I don't get nauseous. And it's just a fun thing to do in the morning just to warm up my brain and understand that everything is a game, that it comes with, your choices come with pros and cons. There's trade-offs. You're not always going to win. And I think my highest self is when I'm playing a game, whether that's basketball or StarCraft or a board game, that's when I show up as my best self. So knowing how you show up as your best self and budgeting time to show up as that, I think is a piece of advice that I would give to people.
People, she just dropped so many gems right there. Like, bam, 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 bam. She was just making it rain. So receive it, receive it. And, you know, take that one and implement it. Take a couple, implement it. But there's so much knowledge and gems. I'm like, uh-huh. And I want to go like, let me take them notes. So I'm going to definitely rewatch this. So what does a day in the life, I know you gave us portions of what that day looks like. What would you say is like a typical day for you?
Yeah, so I'm going to kind of zoom out and talk about my week real quick. So my week is my work week. Monday is a really heavy work day where I schedule lots of meetings. I meet with the CEO of the COO of the company. And then Tuesday and Wednesday are kind of like creative days for me. Tuesday, I use my brain creatively for Passion Planner specifically. And then Wednesday, I do whatever I want. So it's kind of like a weekend and in the middle of the week. And then Thursday is kind of like another Monday. So again, I meet with the COO. I really focus on Passion Planner stuff, moving those things forward. And then Friday, I like to focus on my own personal projects other than Passion Planner. Or if there's anything that's time sensitive for Passion Planner, I work on that. And then the weekend, I do whatever I want. There's no rules for my weekend. So yeah, each day is a little different, but this is kind of what works for me. I am someone that really sprints when I work. So I work really fast and then I need a rest. So I'm not really a longevity kind of worker. My brain works in maybe like 30 minute great sprints and then it's tired and then it needs a break and then I can do it again, especially if I'm working with other people. But if I'm working by myself, I could work a lot longer. But I'm an introvert and I know that about myself. And I think knowing yourself and knowing how your brain works and how you feel comfortable and when you work your best is extremely important as you design your days, because I can set out the schedule and someone's brain might work completely differently. Like I have ADHD. It's like boom, boom, everything so fast. And that's a superpower in some capacities. And I mean, I think it's a superpower for me because I can make all these connections really quickly. And I can make iterations very quickly and I can take an idea and evolve it very fast. But in terms of like sticking to a structure and sticking to a plan and keeping a team accountable, I'm not very good at that. So I have a great person on my team. Her name's Jax. She is the COO of the company and she kind of ensures that all of the details and all the things run smoothly after the point of vision.
Right, right. I noticed that you have certain things planned out, like boom, you know you're gonna have do this week or this day, and then you have your sleeping time because this is serious, and I know you have your playing time throughout that day or week. Why do you think it's important to have, I know that you're not really structured, but there is somewhat of a structure. How would you go on to explain why that's important?
So for me, I know that I need to have consistency with my team and consistency with my, so Jax is also the president of the company. So ensuring that like, if there's any concerns that I have, or if there's anything that I need to address with her, that she's not messaging me like every single day. She knows that we're meeting on Monday or Thursday and we're going to have an hour long meeting where we can discuss all the things. I'm a big believer in batch processing and, keeping the brain focused at the same kind of work. So for me, I use my planner, but I also use my Google Calendar to block out times because I'm having so many meetings with people. So I think for me, the planning actually lays the foundation for spontaneity, because you give yourself a 3-hour chunk of time with some sort of objective or even no objective, but that time is dedicated to nothing, or that time is dedicated to this. And a lot of times when I meet, I really try to be decisive because it stops me from antagonizing on these small details that actually really most times don't really matter. So I like being really decisive in my meetings. The team is really good about being prepped for meetings. So we have all of the details in a doc. We read through the doc beforehand, before the meeting, and then we have a discussion. And the meeting is the discussion. It's not reviewing details that could have just been read to each other. Like, we don't need story time. We need decision making. So I think that that is really important. And I know that when I'm in a meeting with someone, hopefully we're going to make decisions and we're going to be moving the needle forward. So I think that's really important in terms of like just scheduling time. And I can't have too many of those meetings because it takes a lot of brain power. But I think knowing yourself and giving yourself, because when you know yourself, you can give yourself the advantage. And I think that's really important.
A question to ask about that. I was going to ask something else, but this is a... I feel a great question that I know will serve people is, how can one get to know themselves better, because some people go, I don't know what I want. I don't really understand my own self. I'm still trying to figure it out. Like, how would you go about sharing some tips on that?
Yeah, so one of the exercises that I really like to do with people is ask yourself when you feel the most alive. So when you feel the most alive, I think everyone has felt something where they're like, oh, I really love how I feel during this activity. And then, so in the same way that I call myself like gamer angel or basketball angel, like I know how I show up in those spaces. So, you know, everyone is so different. I asked a group of 300 people and very rarely is there any overlap of what activity. So your thing is pretty unique to you. And then you ask yourself, when I do this thing, when I do this activity, how do I show up? Am I courageous? Am I decisive? Am I confident? Am I playful? Am I loud? Whatever. And then you think about the different sectors of your life, whether that's your relationships, whether your work, your leisure, your career, your health. And you think about how you can show up as, for example, me, gamer angel, in regards to my relationships. How do I show up as gamer angel in my career? And you brainstorm different ways to do that and have those characters who show up, because then now you're just, instead of maybe you're only showing up in 1% of your life, well, let's expand that to 10% of your life, 20% of your life, 30% of your life. And slowly you just show up more as yourself because you've given yourself opportunities and, you know, different ideas for how to do that. And once you do that for, I don't know, a few months, it becomes second nature. You're like, oh, I like how I feel. Like, I love how I feel. And knowing yourself really has to do with how you feel and being in tune with that and being aware and attentive to how you feel and slowing down. When I feel a strong emotion, I slow down and I think about, what am I feeling? And I don't try to push through that feeling very quickly, because I think feelings are messengers that are trying to tell you something about yourself. And they're your friends, you know. Even sadness is a friend. It's like, no, maybe not this. This isn't it.
Right. I love that. How they are characters, if you will, our feelings to let us know if we're in tune with and aligned with who we truly are. So thank you for bringing that up. Advice. What was one of the best pieces of advice you've received along your entrepreneurial journey?
Yeah, so it's so interesting because it's so minuscule and it's so, it was so in passing. So I was at this event, this fundraising event that I was volunteering at, and there's this one woman that was really radiant, and I usually don't go up to people and just talk to them, but I went up to her and I was like, hey, you're just so radiant. I just want to thank you for like your presence. And she turns to me, like stops talking to the rest of the group, turns to me and she goes, Sister Goddess, you can't give away anything that you don't have already for yourself. So that compliment that you give me, like you have for you. And that to me is like really important. And I think that that is another, if there's so many lessons in that. There's this concept of you can't take anything personally. Everything that people do and say is the projection of themselves. But you also, on a positive note, can't give things to other people when you don't have it for yourself. So if you don't have, for example, like unconditional love for yourself, if you don't have gentleness for yourself, if you don't have patience for yourself, then you can't really expect that version that you give to other people to be very true. Yeah, I think that, and I don't know if that really has to do with entrepreneurship, but it has to do with life. And for me, like my entrepreneurial journey is my life. I do what I love and I use entrepreneurship as a tool to change the world and impact the world in the way that I want, but also to live my life in the way that I want. And it's like a win-win-win all around. So I'm really fortunate.
Beautiful. All right, I'm gonna start to wrap this up. Those that want to start a business, right? Mm-hmm. So many different tips, ideas. In fact, you shared a lot that, again, doesn't have to be about business, but about life itself. But when it comes to starting a business, especially for those that are starting out, what would you advise?
Choose something that matters to you. Choose something that really matters to you. When you start a business, there are there's so many things that you're going to have to do to help this business grow and flourish that choosing something that really matters to you, that you really want to amplify whatever energy into the world, that energy, like, make sure it's something it's worth losing sleep over, because you're probably going to lose sleep over it. And when you choose something that really matters to you, you'll actually give yourself the advantage, because you'll go into that domain so much more passionate. And also choose a topic that you understand, the difficulties of what the product is solving. Like, understand the problem well, so you can make a really great solution. For me, when I designed Passion Planner, I knew what it meant to be floating directionlessly. I knew what it meant to be someone that's mind is all over the place. I knew what it meant to not feel like I had direction and guidance. So I could create a product that really catered to those problems. So I think that would be one of my pieces of advice for people that are starting.
And then for those that already have an established business and they want to take it to the next level, what would you suggest to them?
I think it's defining what does that level mean to you. Because I think when you say take it to the next level, it always means expansion and growth. But if that impedes on your freedom and your main goal in life is to be free, then rethink the approach. You know, maybe it is. I think that thinking really critically about what that next level looks like to you and to you only, and making sure that your decisions align with that is really, really key and really important. Because if you say, okay, I want to expand, but you don't have the infrastructure to expand or the support, then you're going to be working another 80-hour week for the next however long you get until you get that infrastructure. So really pacing your growth based on what your needs are personally, because once you feel the pressure of people that want your product, then it's like putting out fires playing whack-a-mole, which is, I don't think that's the funnest way to live.
All right, so because this show is called Hustle with Purpose, I know you alluded to this earlier, but it's worth asking again. What does hustle mean to you?
So hustle to me, I think that there's so many forms of hustle. Like, when I think about hustle, when I play sports, it's like giving your all, you know, like putting yourself out on the line. And whenever I hustle for my team. Like, I don't hustle because of me. Like, I hustle because my team is hustling with me. So I think that, to me, hustle is like an effort, an extra effort. And I think that hustling is, there's a time and a place. I don't think that you hustle constantly. I think that's how you burn out. Guarantee you burnout. I think that hustle might be a quiet hustle. It might be, you know, I'm gonna really continue to think about what is it that the world needs, so that this company can thrive for the next 5-10 years. Like, it might not be the position of, oh, I'm gonna be the chief operating officer that is controlling all of these small minute decisions, because I understand where I fit into a team, and understanding where I bring the most value in my hustle and having the discipline to stay in that lane is really, really important. Because hustling just to hustle, I think is like, I don't think it's the most strategic way to go about it.
100% agree with you on that. And what would you say is your purpose behind your hustle?
For me, it's access. I think about access a lot. I think about the privilege that I have. I have so much privilege. I'm an educated person that was born in the United States, as a woman, as a queer woman. I don't have to fear for my life. Like, I have so much privilege and access to things. I was educated in a great college. I had great parents. And for me, like, I could afford a life coach, but not a lot of people can, but a lot of people need it, you know? And I really, really love being able to make tools accessible that usually are only accessible to the privileged and the wealthy. And for me, these tools, I hope, make life a more playful, more fun, less stressful experience, because that's all we want. Like, not everyone wants like this story of like extreme wealth. Some people just want to be happy. And I think that once you get the bases covered of, you know, how to meet your needs, and also how to maintain your mental health, your spiritual health, your physical health, then you can thrive. You can then live life more experimentally and explore different ways of living. And I think for me, that is where the fun of life is.
What do you want to be remembered for?
I think that I made your life less stressful and more fun. That I made you laugh. I think the people that are around me, I try to make laugh. And it's in this weird, geeky, like punny kind of way. And I want people that are in my circle to know like I'm there for them. And like, yeah, like I'm there for them.
Beautiful. All right, so we're gonna get into some rapid fire questions. So answer with the first thing that comes to mind.
Cool.
All right, favorite breakfast food?
Burritos.
Favorite day of the week?
Wednesday.
What profession other than your own would you like to attempt?
High school basketball coach.
Quote that inspires you.
I don't know if that's a profession, but cool.
It is. And it sounds fun. I think you'd be an amazing coach too. A quote that inspires you.
Be who you are and say what you feel, because those who mind don't matter and those who matter don't mind.
Ooh, who's that by?
He's close. He's slightly racist. So, you know, slightly problematic, but that's a great quote. Separating the artist from the art right now.
Who's that by?
Dr. Seuss, Theodore Geisel.
Most useful product you've invested in under $100.
Most useful product. Damn, I want to say passion planner, but I know I can't. So let me think about that. What is a product that I love?
First thing that just comes to mind.
My phone case.
Boom. Hey, that's a lifesaver.
I love this phone case. Yeah. I don't have to carry a wallet. It's perfect. I dropped this phone. I just dropped the phone right now and it's fine.
Bam, under $100, just like that.
Yeah, I think for 20 bucks.
If you could have three people over for dinner, dead or alive, who would they be?
Alicia Keys. Alicia Keys is gonna be my friend one day. I don't know how, I don't know why, but that's what's gonna happen. Alicia Keys. I think everyone says Oprah, but I feel like if this comes true, everyone is, Oprah's just gonna have dinner parties for the rest of her life. Who else? Ellen DeGeneres.
Advice to your younger self.
Oh, chill. Chill, everything's gonna be okay. You're gonna be great. You're already great. And just keep doing you and just enjoy the journey.
What do you think the world needs more of?
Grace and kindness to one another, to ourselves. I think that we are extremely rigid and extremely sharp with ourselves, and that gets amplified to others on social, in person. That I think if we had more grace for ourselves and more patience and kindness to our humanity, then the world would be so much happier and so much more accepting and loving.
What do you think the world needs less of?
Trump.
What do you think a person needs to be happy?
I think they need stillness. I don't think happiness is found in constant movement. At least for me, it's like in deep peace and deep stillness is happiness. Even in moments of chaos and moments of rapid fireness, like it's kind of like when you're like traveling and there's this moment that just feels like it is lasting forever. It's like the only thing that matters. I think that to me is like really deep happiness.
Love it. And for those that are pursuing their passion or purpose, last words of advice.
You can do it and be proud of yourself along the way. Be proud of yourself. I know a lot of us are very externally motivated for other people to be proud of us, to the point that if one person tells you that they're proud of you, you'll probably start crying. And that's how much you need it for yourself. I think that we are all very resilient and we are all very privileged and we're all very lucky for all whatever intents and purposes. And I think that we've all done a lot of hard things and have been able to accomplish so much. But if you keep feeling like you need more and you need more and you need more to be proud of yourself, then this is like another constant battle that you don't have to fight.
Amen to that. Boom. Thank you so much, Angel. Where can people connect with you, find you, so forth and so on?
Yeah, you can just find me on Instagram. My handle is Angelia Trinidad, A-N-G-E-L-I-A. People always spell that wrong. Trinidad, like Trinidad and Tobago. Yeah, Instagram is probably the best way. I post a lot and I read a lot. So yeah.
And then they can go to passionplanner.com.
Yep. So passionplanner.com, Passion Planner's handle is Passion Planner. If you want any planner tips or just if you want to get inspired to put your thoughts on paper, I was listening to Glennon Doyle's book Untamed, which I really love. Maybe I will add that. That will be my less than $100 investment, at least for this year, is a great book. And she talks about how manifesting your dreams happens in one dimension at a time, that you have to put it in 2D and then into 3D, into the real world. And I think if you're interested in how to bridge what is in your mind into the world, I think you need to first put it down on paper. So Passion Planner is a great way to start that.
Beautiful. Well, thank you so much, Angel. I appreciate you. And it's a gift and an honor. And I look forward to connecting with you soon.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Take care.